So good afternoon, everyone. I guess it's still morning, isn't it? But we're close to afternoon. I want to thank you all for coming and welcome you to this August forum. I especially want to thank our presenting sponsors, Portland General Electric. John Maloney's here. Thank you, John. And Riverview Community Bank. Larry, thank you. Also want to thank our educational sponsor, Gresham Barlow School District. And a special thanks to our media sponsor, MetroEast Community Media, and represented by our erstwhile tech guy back there. Thank you. As is our due, we like to recognize our elected officials who are coming today. So if you all could stand, especially welcome representatives Jeff Reardon and Carla Peluso. And our city, and our Gresham City Councilor Lori Stegman, and once again, I want to recognize John Maloney, not just because he represents PGE, but also because he's a board member of the Gresham Area Chamber of Commerce Board of Directors. Thank you. Somebody as the brand new president, I get to rely on. And at this point then, I'd like to turn this over to the chair of our Government Affairs Forum, Mr. Brian Lessler, who will introduce our speakers. Thank you.
Thank you, Warner, and greetings to all of you. I'm glad you came. It's a great turnout. I think you're going to hear some startling, some fascinating and very interesting information today. And I'm very pleased as the chair of this committee. Incidentally, I got there sort of by attrition and through Peter's principles. So as Lynn Snodgrass, who was our former president, became and thankfully so our executive director, Warner, who was the past chair of this committee, became the president, and so I was the last guy standing. And so I have the privilege of introducing these two ladies today. Jean DeMaster is one who probably almost all of you know. She's the executive director of Human Solutions. She sometimes seems like she's everywhere at once, really. If she isn't testifying about the need for more affordable housing in front of Multnomah County Commission, she may be at a community meeting focusing on the revitalization of East Portland or dropping off extra food at one of her organization's shelters. For 30 years, Jean has dedicated her life to combating homelessness in Portland and Multnomah County. She has helped open or overhaul more than a dozen affordable housing complexes or shelters, and most recently culminating in the development of the Human Solutions $19 million Rockwood neighborhood complex. Jean was honored by Portland Metropolitan Area of Realtors as the 2013 Portland First Citizen for her ongoing efforts to combat poverty. Before assuming the helm at Human Solutions, Jean acted as the executive director for both the YWCA of Greater Portland and also the Transitions Project. There she inspired the name of Jean's Place, a homeless shelter for women, which also included services such as mental health and counseling and employment training. Probably most of you know, but Human Solutions' mission is to help low-income and homeless families and individuals gain self-sufficiency by providing affordable housing, family support services, job readiness, training and economic development opportunities. And they've been helping these families build pathways out of poverty for more than 25 years. I know many of you have been big supporters financially and otherwise of Human Solutions efforts. Jean will be retiring soon as the executive director of Human Solutions. She will be missed greatly there, I know, and it will take someone very special to fill her shoes. Jean is a hands-on executive director who has committed her life to helping those less fortunate. So please welcome Jean DeMaster. I'm going to go ahead and introduce Betty Dominguez also, and then we'll turn the whole program over to you ladies. Betty is a director of policy and equity at Home Forward. Home Forward, formerly the Portland Housing Authority. She is another very involved and committed woman. The mission of Home Forward is to assure that the people of the greater Portland Multnomah County community are well sheltered. They have a special responsibility to those who encounter barriers to housing because of income, disability, or special needs. Home Forward promotes affordable housing that engenders stability, self-sufficiency, self-respect, and pride in its residents and represents a long-term community asset. After 70 years, Home Forward remains true to the goals they have championed to shelter and support our neighbors in need. Betty is not just an employee that comes to work, does her job, and goes home. I know that because I work with her at Home Forward. She is tireless. You will find her involved in community or in committees of her choice, and she is highly sought after as a resource to many organizations. She has a great commitment to East County, specifically the community of Gresham. She has been in Gresham for over 17 years, engaged in Rockwood Business Coalition, Rockwood Community Development Coalition, East Metro Economic Alliance, advisory committee member of the East Metro Mediation Program, and in her spare time, she organizes the Snowcap Park Planning Party, is on the Powell Division Steering Committee, Boys and Girls Club Board of Directors, Housing and Community Services State Policy Council, and even TriMet's Name the Bridge Community Committee. We are truly grateful for Betty's commitment to Gresham, and she too is a hands-on policymaker and role model for all of us. So it's my pleasure also to personally welcome Betty to. So it looks like Betty's going to go first today.
That's because I saved the best for last. Thank you for the introduction, Brian. And yes, he is my boss, so I hope he's going to grade me well on this presentation. And can I just say right now, I'm so nervous because I dread public speaking, so I'm glad I can stand here and you won't see my knees knock. So Kayla is going to help us with the slide presentation. You have copies on the table if you'd like to each grab one. And you can take some notes as we go along. So I just wanted to add to Brian's introduction. I've spent 9 years with the Housing Authority, and I spent 9 years with the State Housing Finance Agency prior to that. During that time, I did a lot of work in Gresham, and I was responsible for grant funding and pre-development lending that went to properties like So the crossing at Gresham Civic Station there, Mike Rossman's property, Peak Development at the time. He did Central Point in downtown historic Gresham. Later on, he did the property that became the Behringer Lofts, and we did the land loan on that. I sat on Metro's Todd Steering Committee, so did a lot of Todd and money, transit-oriented develop money investments in the Gresham area, including much of what is vacant land in Civic Station right now. So had an opportunity to work in this community for a long time, and it's always been very close to my heart. I really do love the city. So we're gonna talk a little bit about the face of poverty right now. Let me tell you a little bit about who we are first. So we were created in 1941 in response to the need for wartime housing for shipyard workers. We are the largest developer of affordable housing in the state. We own over 6,000 units of housing in Multnomah County that range from studios to group homes to up to 5 and 6 bedroom units. Not a lot of those though. And we administer another 9,000 Section 8 vouchers. So all told, we have over 15,000 households in our care. In 1941, in the first 2 years that we were created, we developed housing for 72,000 people. again, workers in the shipyard. So you may have heard of Vanport City, and that was our start. So we've been doing affordable housing for people in need for quite a long time. In addition to our Section 8 vouchers, we also coordinate other types of rental assistance in collaboration with partner agencies, including our very good partner, Human Solutions. We do housing for domestic violence victims, housing for veterans, military veterans. We do housing pilot programs right now, for instance, with New Avenues for Youth, for foster kids who have aged out of the system but have not yet completed school and don't have a place to land. And we do short-term rent assistance programs that's administered through 19 contractors throughout the county, one of which is Human Solutions. So, next slide, please. So Brian touched a little bit on what some of our mission is and what's important to us, and I wanted to point out the highlighted line there. We believe that everyone deserves a roof over their head and that everyone is capable of improving their lives regardless of their current condition. So everyone is entitled to a pathway to success, whatever that might mean for them, but that won't start unless they have adequate housing that's affordable, decent, and sanitary. In 2011, we changed our name to Home Forward from the Housing Authority of Portland. To avoid confusion, people thought we were part of the Portland Housing Bureau, and it also didn't accurately represent the geography that we covered because we served the whole county. So people knew us for, 70 years as HAP, and we didn't want to lose that sort of moniker. So you'll see we've capitalized instead on hope, access, and potential. And that's what we're hoping to achieve for our residents. Next, please. So real quickly, and you can see in your packets better, this is a map of the properties that we own within Multnomah County. Of those 6,000 hard units that we own, only 405 are located in Gresham's primary zip 97030. So we don't have a large presence out here compared to other parts of the county. The next slide. I'll just go through these fast and you could look at them later in detail at your leisure. Shows the growth in Section 8 vouchers in the county over the last 10 years. So if you look at the Gresham Zip 97030, let's see, do I have a pointer? Is it working? No. Oh, right there. You'll see that there were 414 voucher holders at the time this map was prepared. As of today, there are 443 voucher holders in that Gresham zip out of the 9,000 vouchers that we administer. The next slide shows the elderly and disabled folks that we serve that are holding Section 8 vouchers. So if you look at that same zip code, the 97030, it looks like roughly 200 to 300 of the 400 vouchers that are deployed out here are held by folks that are elderly or disabled. And that's sort of representative of our whole voucher portfolio. 60% of our 9,000 vouchers are held by elderly and disabled, 25% to 30% by working families. But shelter's not enough for folks. We need to figure out other ways to move them down that pathway to success, and you'll hear more about that later. The next slide, I just wanted to touch briefly. I don't want to spend a lot of time on Section 8, but I know it's a subject that people have a lot of interest in. And I think there's a lot of misunderstanding about who's taking or able to use the Section 8 vouchers. Like I said, many elderly and disabled, many working families. Over a year ago, we did a project together with the Gresham Police Department where we tracked the police department's arrests for a 12-month period and cross-checked it to our databases. And you can see the numbers there month by month. So arrests for the 12-month period totaled 3414, and our matches to our records totaled 92. So less than 3% of the total arrests. But what's important to know is those arrests aren't necessarily voucher holders or people that lived with us. There were a few of those, but it's also, when we cross-checked the database against arrests, we had several juvenile runaways. We have veterans who have a PTSD episode and create commotion, and the police get called out for that. We had shelter plus care folks. That means that we provide the shelter, the rent assistance, and then the folks there are in the care of other service provider partners. So if they have a drug and alcohol addiction problem or a mental health problem, we shelter them, then they're case managed by Cascadia Behavioral or Central City Concern or something like that. So it's important. I mean, we only had 3% of all the arrests, and they include so many more kinds of folks in housing than what one might have thought were Section 8 residents. So our folks are not a big source of crime, and I think that's an important thing to understand, because a lot of times there's misperceptions about that. So next slide, please. Who exactly is living in poverty? I think you might be surprised to find just who is living in poverty. There are certainly many, many folks in poverty at various income levels, including the homeless and those with special needs, the elderly and disabled. And Jean's going to talk about those folks more a little bit later and talk about causes of poverty and give some more data. But the vast majority of folks in poverty are working families and individuals. They're working poor. So how is that possible, you might ask? Well, let's take a look. Okay, can you guys hear my knees yet? Because they're knocking. So, thanks, boss. So many of you have heard about the federal poverty level. It's a guideline used for determining financial eligibility for certain federal programs like Medicaid, for instance. The guideline was established in 1964, and the formula for that hasn't changed since then, rendering it outdated and ineffective. The methodology used to determine the federal poverty level was primarily based on USDA food budgets that met minimal nutritional standards in the late 1950s. So today, the federal poverty level for a family of four is listed as $23,850. Now keep in mind how old the formula is that has established that definition. In comparison, and what's new in the country today is what is called the self-sufficiency standard. This term describes how much income families of different sizes and compositions need to make ends meet without public or private assistance. Private means that grandma's babysitting, that you're getting food boxes from your churches, or somebody else is giving you a ride to work, that kind of thing. It's a measure of income sufficiency that's based on the cost of housing, basic needs for working families, including housing, utilities, child care, food, health care, transportation, and taxes, paying their taxes. Work Systems Inc. commissions a study every 3 years and publishes it in an effort to demonstrate how much income is actually needed to realistically support a family. From their perspective, by understanding the profile of households in our region less likely to be self-sufficient, they are able to focus efforts towards training and job placement assistance, targeting these job seekers to prepare them for occupations that we know will pay a self-sufficient wage. So the self-sufficiency standard for a family of four today, and that takes into account one child in school who may need after-school care and one a preschooler who's not yet in school, is $65,500. Huge difference between that and the federal poverty level. In the 1950s and early 60s, we didn't have as many working moms. We didn't have as many single parent households. Child care expenses weren't an issue. Certainly everything has gone up in the years since. But if a family at the federal poverty level is able to get ahead and make a tiny bit more money, then they are eliminated from eligibility for any federal programs like food stamps or Medicaid. But the money that they may have earned, the additional money that pushed them over the edge, is not enough to make up the gap. So that's something we call the benefits cliff. It's like when you're struggling, you're working, you're trying to get ahead, you get just over that poverty level, and boom, all the supports are drawn out from under you, and you're not yet at that level of self-sufficiency. So that creates a huge number of folks in a lot of need. So Gina is going to give you more examples around some of that in a minute. Next slide, please. So I wanted to make this a little more local for us. So a while back, Bill Peterson asked me to make a presentation to Troutdale Rotary. And so I prepared this document for them, and I've updated it for today. And I want you to look at the left-hand column. So first, under wages, you see the Troutdale Outlet Mall with about 300 employees at minimum wage. and I calculated, depending on the number of hours they work, what their annual income will be. And then the very far right column there is the corresponding income levels according to HUD, and I'll show you what those are in a minute. Right below that is the FedEx distribution facility with over 800 employees who make between $10 and $15 an hour and average between 35 and 40 hours a week. And once again, you can see what their annual income is and what that equates to in HUD speak in terms of income that qualifies them for affordable housing. The home ownership piece on the right side, you know, there was a strong effort out here not too long ago about live near work, and actually jobs, housing, transportation balances are really key to healthy communities. It's good when people can live near work. It's good when they don't have to travel long distances to get from work to home. It's good for the employer because they're not out so much because the child has a dental appointment. It's good for them to spend the money they earn out here in this community instead of in Tigard or somewhere else that they may be living. So the Live Near Work initiative at the time was focused on home ownership. So I did just a real quick example here of what it would take for one of those FedEx workers to be able to buy a home. So some of them, you know, don't even make as much as what a 10% down payment would be. And a 10% down payment today isn't preferred by lenders. That puts you at a 90% loan to value. They prefer 20% down payment. So how would these workers ever accumulate? How long would it take them to accumulate that down payment? Maybe it's a gift from their parents. So if so, I backed into what the principal and interest and taxes insurance would be on that net mortgage amount. I did not add private mortgage insurance because at a 90% loan to value, you would need that as well. So that expense number is even a little higher. And then if you back into that to see, you know, both for rental and for home ownership, folks look at 30% of your income as paying for your housing costs. So when you back into what they need to earn per hour, it's $24 an hour or $50,000 annually. These workers aren't making that money yet. It's going to be a long time before they can buy a home. So where do they live in the meantime? Well, they can qualify to live in what's called affordable housing all day long until they get to those higher income levels. So if we flip to the next slide. So this is from the HUD sheets that depict annual incomes, and the flip side will show you annual rents. And it's the basis that everybody that develops affordable housing is bound to. If you use the federal low-income housing tax credits to help build the project, if you use home dollars from any jurisdictions, including the city of Gresham, you are bound by these income levels. So if you look to the yellow line there, if you're a single person making $25,000 a year, and I hope I'm reading that right, my copy's too small, that's a 50% income. So nobody on the other sheet was making 50% except the $15 an hour at 40 hours a week. So what should that rent level be for that person who's at a 50% income level? If you look to the next slide, if they want to rent a one-bedroom apartment, I can't even read that. What is that? $689? So can they find an apartment in this area for $689? If Rosa, the bank teller, is making $10 an hour, so that equates to an annual income of $20,800 based on 40 hours a week, 52 hours a year. So that means Rosa is at less than a 45% median income level. And if you were to look back on your page, you know, between incomes and rents, you would see a single person at 45% should pay about $620 a month in rent. But what if she's a single mom? Then you look at that sheet and you say her income level for two people, and it's less than that 45%. So the corresponding rent on the flip side should be less than if she were living alone. If she has two children, then that's even more difficult. with one child, she falls into a less than 40% income level, and her rent should be $551 for a one-bedroom, which means that either she and her child share a room, or she sleeps on the couch and her child is in the room. If she has two children, and if they're the same gender, they can easily sleep in the same bedroom. But if they're opposite genders and under a certain age, they can, but at another age, they cannot. HUD does not want mixed gender siblings in a single room. So you can see where a single parent might really have to struggle for the rent that they can afford, and given their family makeup, and they frequently rent burden themselves. They spend more than that 30% number. And if they have to travel long distance from home to work and they've got unreliable transportation, the car breaks down, insurance, gas, mechanic stuff, easily a family or an individual could spend 70% of their income on housing and transportation, which doesn't leave them much at all for any of the other necessities of life. So think about that in the context of the several hundred acres of industrial land that the Port of Portland owns in Troutdale, and then of course here in the Gresham Vista Business Park. And I've been working with a couple of the fellows from the port, and as they start to do some recruitment around private sector, traded sector job opportunities there, we're going to look at what they think income levels are going to be, and we're going to try to sort of estimate, like the FedEx facility, how many thousands more workers are going to come here, may not live here yet and need housing, or have housing here but it's not affordable. I mean, we need to plan ahead. We need to think about 10 years down the road when those 3,800 jobs are out here, where people are living, how they're driving, and where they're spending their earnings. It'd be really great to earn it here and spend it here instead of in Clark County. So the next slide is an excerpt from an article that the Gresham Outlook did in January of 15. And it was really about, the title was Snowcapped Community Charities Donated Firewood from Trees Removed from Transit Platforms. And it was all about how TriMet upgraded 7 Gresham Max platforms and took down trees and then ended up donating the wood to Snowcap. And most people would have read that and said, oh, okay, cool. It was TriMet focused story. But what I zeroed in on that is this woman, Anna Wallace, 70 years old, Gresham resident, still waitressing at the Red Lobster. How many times have we eaten at Red Lobster and looked at our waitresses? Living in a drafty house where she can't afford the electricity, and she wrote to Snowcap and said, can you help me find firewood? It's the only place I can, the only way I can heat my place. And mostly then over, only the living room, so likely she's sleeping in the on the couch. If that woman was fortunate enough to live with us or Human Solutions or any of the other nonprofit housing providers, she wouldn't have that problem. So if she can't afford a bill, is she struggling to pay for her medications? Is she struggling to keep food? We find often that among our elderly population, while we can shelter them, we can't provide those other resources, and they will choose between food and medicine, and that's just not right. So the other big issue, and I just want to tell you, bring it a little closer to home. How many of you know Catherine Nicewood? So she gave me permission to share her story. Catherine is the president of the Rockwood Neighborhood Association. She's very involved in community things here in Gresham. When she was young, she was diagnosed with multiple sclerosis. Her parents were grass seed farmers in a rural part of the state and would have to drive several hours up to Portland for her to get the kind of medical care that she needed. And after a while, it became too difficult, especially as the parents aged, and she needed to be living in Portland permanently and have access to all her specialty doctors. Well, Catherine lived with Home Forward in a project we call Holgate House. That's a congregate care sort of scenario where she had help with housekeeping and help people taking her, you know, to the grocery store and doing her shopping and doing her laundry. And she lived with us for a number of years. And she would still be with us today if, when her parents passed, they hadn't left her a living trust that she used to buy a small house in the Rockwood area, in which she uses to pay for her medical expenses and schooling. She's going to school right now. But that's the face of people that are in poverty that need the kind of assistance. And it's your neighbor. It's the folks down the street. You know, you never really think about who they are. So I just want to finish with a short little video. So affordability is a big issue for folks in poverty, but conditions of living units are sometimes even a bigger issue. Many of you heard me say over the many years I've been working out here that there's a big difference between affordable by accident and affordable by design or intentionally affordable. That's the housing that we build, or Gene builds, or Catholic Charities build, where we're always going to be there and we always maintain the property and we bring services to the residents, really important services, whether it's job training or whatever it might be, that puts them on that path to success. What's accidentally affordable is what's out there in the market that's in such poor condition that the landlords can only ask for so much rent, and poor folks will live in those substandard conditions because it's all that they can afford. So watch this video.
It does come at a cost. It is often substandard, and this leads to adverse effects on people's health.
It's pretty heartbreaking. I neglected to mention that that particular property is in the vicinity of 162nd and Stark, and we wouldn't actually name the site, but it's in our neighborhood. And so now, thank you. We'll probably take questions at the end, and I'm really delighted to turn it over now to my friend, Gene DeMaster.
Thank you, and thank you for inviting me today. You probably wonder what is left to say. I wonder that myself, but I will do the best I can. On your tables, you have a handout from Human Solutions, and we try to put everything together in one packet for you today. And so I'm going to start on, had we numbered the pages, it would have been page 10. So we're going to start with this chart right here. And in talking about low-income families, in talking about who's living in poverty, we want to recognize that there are four groups of people that are disproportionately highly represented in the group of people of who's living in poverty. And okay, I'm good at this one. Yep, that one. Okay, and so it is communities of color and immigrants, and as we saw on the film, represented in the film, primarily children are much more overrepresented in who's living in poverty. Single parent households are, and seniors and people with disabilities are overrepresented in the population of who's living in poverty. When we talk to people at Human Solutions about living in poverty, and we serve about 87,000 people a year in East Portland and East Multnomah County, all of whom are low income or people living in poverty. And we ask them, you know, what do they want to have changed? What is it like? What can we do? And what they talk to us about is that they talk about living in substandard housing, like we saw in the film, with no option to move. Now, if we lived in substandard housing, we would move next week. If you saw cockroaches or you saw mold, you'd move next week. But families that we serve, and I think families in this in the video, have no option to move. We talk, mothers talk a lot about not having enough for their families to eat, of running out of food by the end of the month, running out by three quarters of the month, getting a food box from snow camp, and then running out of the food box, not having enough to eat, and particularly having their children go hungry, not having access to nutritional food, and always living under the pressure. And what they talk about is the real pressure of being a low-income person, the real pressure of always wondering, is this check going to bounce? Is my credit going to be cut off when I give a credit card? Are my utilities going to be cut off when I get home? Is there going to be an eviction notice? But living in poverty means living with this precariousness of something bad is going to happen, and always having to be on the lookout for that happening. People talk to us about having medical emergencies. In particular, medical emergencies, you go to the medical clinic, you pay for your child's medical care, and then you know as well as not you aren't going to have the money for next month's rent. And then you start in on bouncing a check or having your credit cards cut off. But it's that constant pressure of any one event, even a car breakdown or a medical emergency, puts you into a crisis. People talk to us about having a car breakdown and having it result in you take the bus to work. Okay, you can take the bus to work, but it means your kids can't go to after-school programs anymore. Because if they go to after-school programs, they have to get home. You have to pick them up, and your car is not running anymore. So what it means is your kids can't go to after-school programs because they're going to ride the bus home right after school instead of waiting for you to pick them up after they go to classes. So that means they don't get the same opportunities as other kids. And people talk to us about being low income, about being embarrassed or feeling guilty or the shame of being a low income person. We would like that not to be, but many people talk about being guilty and feeling bad for their families because they're a low income person. We looked at poverty in East Multnomah County for this presentation, and we defined East Multnomah County as 82nd Avenue east to the Hood River County line. So it took into account part of Portland, but also Fairview, Gresham, Wood Village, Troutdale, and the unincorporated part of Multnomah County. We know that Gresham is the fourth largest city in the state with a population in 2013 of 109,000. Eric, we're probably at 110 or 115 by now. Right. But we also know that two out of every five Multnomah County residents live in East Multnomah County. East Multnomah County, as all of us know who live in East Multnomah County, is becoming more diverse. It has strengths, it has weaknesses, but people of color now account for one quarter of the population of East Multnomah County. We are slightly more diverse than Multnomah County as a whole, whose percentage of people of color is just about 20%. East County's non-white population grew by 42% from 2000 to 2012. The East Multnomah County median household income is $46,900, and that's 91% of what the county's median income is. So ours is a little bit lower. It varies by zip code, but our household income in East Multnomah County is lower than it is for all of Multnomah County. Particularly the one that's the most important to us at Human Solutions in trying to overcome poverty, overcome homelessness. Of East County's population who are 25 years and older, 19% hold a bachelor's degree compared to 39% for the county overall. Huge difference of number of people who have a bachelor's degree. 17% of the adults in East County lack a high school diploma. In all of Multnomah County, 10%. Lack a high school diploma, but in East Multnomah County, it's 17%. Just a couple more of these statistics to look at who lives in poverty, kind of why we have poverty, and then to look at, well, what are some of the things that we can do? We know that the four-year high school graduation rate is 67% in East County, but 71% in overall in Multnomah County. We looked at the minority enrollment in schools, and it grew 29% from 2003 to 52% in 2013. And at that same period of time, school enrollment only went up about 8%. 42%, there's only a few more of these. 42%, well, actually there's pretty many. 42% of the students in the Portland Public Schools are eligible for free and reduced lunch. But in the East County schools, it's 54% to 78%, depending on which school district you're looking at. So a much higher percentage of free and reduced lunch, which reflects a much higher percentage of people living in poverty. Yep, okay. Yep, because Betty already talked with them. So what is being done to combat poverty in East Multnomah County? I think the first thing we want to say is poverty is an overwhelming issue that there is no one easy answer to. So lots of things are being done, but the number of people in poverty, the severity of the poverty, and the complexity of the problem make one kind of one-shot solutions help but not overcome the problem. So to help, Multnomah County increased its funding for anti-poverty and self-sufficiency services in 2010 and in 2013, both times in response to the number of children with free and reduced lunch going up. Then our percentage of funding in East Multnomah County went up, and funds will be reallocated again in 2016 based on poverty levels. And so we would expect an increase here in East Multnomah County. More Sun schools opened in East Multnomah County. The KELK program is proven itself to be very successful. STEM is certainly gaining successful outcomes. Department of Labor and Health and Human Services have both opened employment programs, recognizing that if people can't get high enough wages, they are going to always live in poverty. So both departments have opened up employment programs. Our programs for seniors and people with disabilities remain strong. The programs, particularly with the Gresham Police Department, the neighborhood enforcement teams, are strong. And many foundations give a priority, especially the large foundations, give a priority for programs that serve Rockwood and East Multnomah County. Looking at just the nonprofit agencies, just really quickly, My Father's House, as many of you know who attended the opening last Friday, has opened new apartments for homeless families. Join is a nonprofit agency funded to do outreach to homeless people on the streets in East Multnomah County and get them into housing. The Rockwood CDC is formed for redevelopment. Project Access Now has been created to coordinate services. Snowcamp has expanded its capacity for food storage and fresh produce. Human Solutions is building new apartments for low-income families, and with Wallace Medical Concern is building a dental clinic in the Rockwood area. Rosemary Anderson High School has been formed and is operational. Boys and Girls Clubs is in the process of forming a new facility for like 300 children. The DACA Park is opening soon. I mean, these aren't even all the examples. I mean, there's more. But poverty is such a complex issue that unless we get coordinated strategies, we're not going to be able to overcome it. A pinpoint here, a pinpoint here, a pinpoint here will not overcome the level of poverty that we're looking at. I want to just point out a number of the things that I think the city of Gresham is doing to try and get a handle on the overall solutions to poverty. In particular, the city has created the Gresham Prosperity Initiative, which is a citywide approach toward alleviating poverty and getting prosperity for all residents. The city has also looked at the economic development focus, trying to get traded sector jobs paying family wages into the area in the Gresham Renewal area, as well as in the Rockwood Urban Renewal Catalyst site. I think we're looking at the issue of if we can bring in more jobs for everybody, then sort of the rising tide raises all boats for low-income people and for middle-income people. But there's no way we're going to eliminate poverty if we don't raise income levels and prosperity levels for everybody. Okay, I'm going to skip that page because I want to make sure that we have time for questions and just go to the last page. So how do we help low-income citizens and how do we look at prosperity at the same time? I think that they're both linked. I think that you can't look at overcoming poverty unless we look at raising the prosperity level of the whole city. But in terms of poverty, I think we need to look at intergenerational poverty. We know that there's families where grandparents were in poverty, their children were in poverty, and now we're seeing their children in poverty. Our goal at Human Solutions, one of our goals, is to not see their children be living in poverty. We want to stop the intergenerational poverty. And one way to do that is give incentives for children to graduate from high school. If people can't get jobs that they can earn a living wage, then they can't get themselves out of poverty. So we know that we have to provide education for people. If somebody is living at and earning minimum wage, if you have a mom with one child and she's earning minimum wage, her take-home salary is going to be about $1,200 a month. But if she pays $800 for her rent, if she pays $150 for her food, if her utilities average about $150 if you average them for the month, and she has to get to work, the whole $1,200 is used up right there, and there's no money left for childcare. She can't work without childcare. All of us know that childcare costs hundreds of dollars every month. So you have to be able to have a job that you can afford food, utilities, rent, and childcare. And people need to be able to pay for medical care for their children as well. So we have to be able to keep kids in school so that they can get jobs above minimum wage levels. We need to incentivize kids graduating from high school, especially at-risk kids, and incentivize people going to community colleges and graduating with associate degrees and going to four-year colleges. Particularly for children who have parents who have never been to college, we need to give an incentive because those kids won't have the example of their parents to follow, so there needs to be an incentive for them. We also need to ensure that our schools have the funding that they need to teach kids, and that they clearest example I can see is I also work with the David Douglas School District, and when they built the Earl Boyles Child Development Academy, they had so many people wanting to move into the Earl Boyles neighborhood, both low-income and middle-income families, because they wanted their kids to go to that school. I think we have to know that here in Gresham, we have to ensure that our schools are so good that people want to come here because they want their kids to go to Gresham schools, knowing that they will get a good education. Secondly, I think we need to bring family wage jobs here. Everybody agrees we need to bring family wage jobs here, but I think when we bring family wage jobs, at least on some of those jobs, we need to have community benefits agreements, which would mean that if the city is providing a tax break for the company to come here, or they're getting land at a lower cost than they might otherwise, that the company should agree that they will hire a certain number of people from Gresham so that their workforce is from Gresham and not allow the workforce to be from Clark County or Happy Valley or some other nice place. They need to have a community benefits agreement that says if you get a break from the city of Gresham, that giving back, you should employ Gresham residents, particularly if you have family wage jobs and we can get people out of poverty. We think that, in terms of Human Solutions, we think that we have to increase community livability. We have to make an attractive place for people who have middle incomes to come and live. If people with middle incomes come and they have disposable income, then there are more jobs for people, there are higher wages for people, and that's the only way we'll end poverty for low-income people. So we think that we think even though we build housing that's affordable, there needs to be attractive middle-income housing. We think that the environmental and sustainability initiatives have to be here because people want those things and it makes neighborhoods more livable. Clearly, having more parks is what people look for, great schools. Just the quality of life, if it raises for everybody, it'll raise clearly for low-income people. Just quickly, two last thing before I stop and we have time for questions. At Human Solutions, we believe that we need to value diversity, we need to strengthen international ties, we need to promote cultural pride for everybody. That oftentimes we hear the problem is there's too many people of color, or see how many people of color are moving in, that's why we have so much poverty. I think we need to turn that around and say having a diverse community is a strength of ours. It makes us an international community. It makes us, we can make it make us more attractive to people, and we need to always turn that around to say that's a strength that we have that other neighborhoods don't have. And finally, kind of going back to how do we resolve poverty for low-income people, I think we need to recognize that poverty is a very complex problem and a one-shot service will not end it. If we need to have housing for affordable housing for low-income people, but just housing isn't enough if people can't get jobs. And people can't get jobs if they haven't graduated from high school unless they get job training. And when they're getting jobs and when they're starting in, they have to get childcare. So we have to look at solutions that are kind of wraparound solutions that really solve a problem, that are not just one-shot things that solve a little bit of it, but let the rest go. So let me stop there, and then Betty and I will both be very happy to answer any questions that you have that are really easy and we know the answers to. No.
Well, if those comments don't stimulate some questions, you guys are all asleep. So wake up. I want to hear from you, and we need this microphone. I'm going to pass that around. So who's first? Oh, come on. Goodness gracious. Thank you.
Thank you, ladies. Great information. So I have a question. I hear landlords often complain when you talk about Section 8 housing that if they accept Section 8 housing, that there's a lag for like the inspection process, and that in the meantime that they could possibly lose rents. And so I just wanted to know what your organization, is that a valid argument? And if it is, what types of things are planned to alleviate that, to make Section 8 housing easier and more economical for private landlords to rent out to those Section 8 holders?
Okay, let's have Betty answer from the Housing Authority, and I'll answer as a landlord.
So let me distinguish first. Section 8 vouchers, many of them are tenant-based, which means the tenant is qualified income-wise to receive a voucher. They have to go in there, out there, and find housing within a certain amount of time. And then we also do project-based vouchers, where we will commit vouchers to a particular development. For instance, a Human Solutions one, like the Rockwood building, we just put vouchers into the quad development that's taking place. Quadriplegics United Against Dependency, that's coming into Gresham soon, so things like that. So I'm going to talk about the tenant-based vouchers. So when we send folks out there to find a unit, and they, and you've heard about the new legislation that happened with Section 8, you can't discriminate based on source of income anymore. So we do have to go out and inspect the units because that's a HUD requirement, and we're looking for housing quality standards. They need to be safe, decent housing. We're not going to put somebody with a voucher in the kind of housing you just saw. So we have a whole team of inspectors. We try to move that as quickly as possible. We've also done some exceptions around landlords that have done a lot of work with us in the past and have had a lot of Section 8 clients in the past. And with some of those folks, we actually won't go and inspect right when they're starting to lease the unit, because we know turnover time, you know, can cause delays in renting and revenue. But we will then, at some point in time, randomly inspect those units to make sure that they're, you know, meeting the housing quality standards set by HUD. A lot of times we'll go out and we'll find a unit where the closet's off track, and maybe there's a burner not working on the stove, and maybe these are folks we've worked with before. And instead of going back to reinspect that they've fixed them, we will trust them to fix it. And then again, at some point in time later in the future, you know, we will go out and audit them when they don't expect it. So we're really trying to turn that around as quickly as we can. We do a lot of work with landlords. We have landlord newspaper. We're planning on our website a landlord portal, which will get them into all kinds of areas of information.
Yeah, I think as a landlord, it's certainly true that if you are going to accept a Section 8 voucher, there is going to be a time lag. There's no question about that, and that means your unit is going to sit vacant. But first of all, it is a HUD requirement, so there isn't really any choice that the Housing Authority has, and the Housing Authority has cut down that time lag markedly. So yes, it's still there, but it's much quicker turnaround than it used to be. And if you didn't send people out and inspect, then you would end up with housing vouchers in units like you saw in that film. And we shouldn't be having our taxpayer dollars, our Section 8 vouchers, paying for that kind of housing. Now you can rest assured that all of the housing that HAP is Home Forward is providing is of a high quality because it's being inspected, and you wouldn't know that that wouldn't happen otherwise.
Bank teller only making $10 an hour with a couple of kids who really can't make it on her own, she may very well be a recipient of a Section 8 voucher because she's income qualified, especially based on the size of her family. So she's working, but she's not making enough to cover her whole rent, and so we will go in and bridge that difference. So it's important to think about using a Section 8 voucher.
Just an added comment in regards to that question. Today's multifamily housing market is about as tight as it's been historically in the 40-some years that I've been in real estate development business in this area. In many cases, it's below 2% vacancy rates. The average turn for a unit when it becomes vacant in many of the submarkets is 1 to 2 weeks. So there's waiting lists at many places. This makes it incredibly difficult for voucher holders to find a place at any price, much less one that's affordable. So it's a real dilemma in today's market. Other questions, please? Yes, sir.
Yeah, there's been a lot of discussion about raising the minimum wage. So let's say that it did get up to, over a period of a few years, it got up to $13.50, $15, pick your number. Could you comment on how that would impact your business and services?
Yeah. If the minimum wage went from $9.25, which where it is right now, up to $13.50, for example, it would mean that people would have $8,000 more to spend on housing, health care, medical care, it would make a huge difference to the low-income families that we serve. Instead of being so precarious, a lot of the families we serve are earning minimum wage. And instead of being so precarious at minimum wage, they would actually have enough money to begin to provide for their families, begin to be able to have some economic security. And so people talk about, well, if they went from minimum wage to $13.50 an hour, then they wouldn't be able to get low-income energy assistance anymore from the utility companies. Well, low-income energy assistance is $300 a year. Going from minimum wage up to $13.50 is $8,000 a year. So the families we serve would be far more stable if they had a higher income level.
Yeah, that would help a lot, Representative, to bridge that benefits cliff, that gap between the federal poverty level and the self-sufficiency standard. But even at $15 an hour times 40 hours a week, that's an annual income of $31,200. So an individual could probably live fairly well on that, but families, much more difficult.
Other questions, please?
And also just to point out that where minimum wage is at $9.25 an hour. If you had the same, we're getting about About 40% of that is what families on welfare get. So they don't get anywhere. I mean, minimum wage is a high increase for families that are on welfare. So the other thing is to, if we're looking at combating poverty, look at the amount we pay on welfare and the amount we do for childcare-related expenses to get people off welfare.
Other thoughts, questions? Yes, Lila and then Sue.
My concern is we raise the minimum wage, and then what happens to all of those of us in business? We have to raise our wages or our price on everything that we sell. So how are we going to reach a level playing field where everyone has what they want?
We have the same issue at Human Solutions. We have about 100 employees at Human Solutions, and our family advocates are at about $12 to $15 an hour. So if minimum wage went from $9 to $15 an hour, we would have to raise all the other wages for all the other people. And we cannot figure out how we would do that unless the state or the county would also raise their subsidy to us, which we know they won't. So the nonprofit agencies are in the same predicament that you are. I think that's why we do have to raise it, but at least we have to graduate it so that we can begin to make these changes gradually. But you're right, there is no other way other than raising all the wages for the people above. So that's why I'm retiring. Now, let me, I can't solve that problem, so I'm just going to go away. But I did want to take just a minute, and it's not fair, but just a minute to introduce Andy Miller. Andy Miller is the new director of Human Solutions. He and I are co-directors now for August and September, and then I will be gone beginning October 1st to go be the caregiver for my grandchildren. I couldn't be happier. But I'm going to leave that problem to Andy to solve.
I can't wait to solve it, but I do want to say I'm in my third week on board at Human Solutions. It's a great thrill to be here. A huge challenge and huge shoes to fill in succeeding Gene, but I look forward to an ongoing relationship with the Chamber, and if we can be partners with you in any way on any of the issues that have been outlined today, we'd love to be. So please reach out to us. I'll be reaching out to you through the next year or two and
So this question is probably for Betty. In the video that you did and you showed us the poor conditions that some people live in, so when you become aware of that, what tools or who can you work with in order to get situations like that corrected?
So the units that you saw in the video were not subsidized units. Units that were developed by a nonprofit or the housing authority. That's private market development. Again, that's where you have landlords who don't pay attention, they don't put money back into the properties, they fall into disrepair. And particularly for immigrant families that have language barriers, they're really taken advantage of. And that's how we end up in situations like that. We would never build anything like that. And, you know, our 6,000 units, I won't say are pristine, but they're pretty darn good. But we would also never approve anybody with a voucher to go into a unit like that. So that's an issue that we need to tackle with the private market. Building intentionally affordable housing to provide folks with safe, sanitary shelter and opportunity to access services, job training, and whatever else that they might need is what we need to do given the level of poverty out here, including the working poor. The second half of that equation then is how do we deal with those blighted properties? And I think that's something that the community as a whole with some stakeholders should start to take a look at. And I think that there are some possible pathways that we can pursue out there. I just wanted real fast, Lila, to say on the $15 an hour thing, we went to a $15 an hour minimum wage last fall. We have over 300 employees and two union shops. but a large number of our staff were making $10 an hour or less, and they're living in our housing. They were living with us and working with us. So it was kind of like, are you going to walk your talk? So we raised the minimum wage for our employees, but completely understand that for small businesses, that is so difficult, and even for larger, medium-sized businesses. So there's this place where the two things aren't meeting. You know, you can't sustain your business or grow it if you're paying more out in wages necessarily, but if you're not paying decent wages and these people can't thrive or survive, they're not going to stay with you very long. They're going to have all the kinds of problems that Jean talked about. So it's a real conundrum. You know, how do we sort of marry these two ends to find that solution in the middle?
Last question, Yuri.
Uh-oh.
This isn't a question. I just wanted to Sue's question. Under the leadership of our city council a number of years ago, the city adopted one of the most robust rental housing inspection programs out there. And for that unit, I don't know if that's in Gresham. If it is, we should talk. But half the program is complaint driven. Half the program is a random inspection on a complex. A unit like that would trigger more inspections within the same complex until the issues were rectified. On the flip side of it, for really responsible multifamily property owners who don't have those types of issues, then they end up getting inspected less. So there's multiple dynamics to the program, but definitely that would be something that the city would be very interested in, and the tools are available to rectify it if we know about it, or if it gets pulled up in the random selection.
I just want to say the city of Gresham has been very responsive in getting the inspectors out to the units. Portland has has fewer inspectors and doesn't have as strong a program, but Gresham has a very strong program. The problem is that if families like you're seeing in the video, if they don't complain, then the city of Gresham won't know. And if they do complain and they're forced to move, either they're forced to move because the landlord says, okay, I'm going to fumigate the whole unit, you have to move, they may not be able to find another unit at the rate they were paying for that unit. So it's really a double-edged sword for a lot of people. But the city of Gresham is great on sending the inspectors out.
Well, we've run out of time. A very interesting topic. Thank you very much, ladies, for your insightfulness and information. I know this is a big issue, and there's a lot of tension over this on every side. So hopefully we'll continue to work together as a community to find solutions and answers to these problems. I believe personally, and that over the last couple of decades, the problem of homelessness and poverty has escalated, and it's visceral. It's visible. You can see it. You can see it on the street corners. You can see it under the trees in the parks. You can see it everywhere you go. We've got to try to find solutions to it. And I love Gene's comments that I think economic development is a powerful tool, because as our community becomes more vibrant, as business can work with the nonprofits to help to fund some of these things, our community is going to be more vibrant, our schools will be better, and we'll all have a better quality of life. So we need to raise the water level for everybody in our community. With that, I'm going to turn it over to our president, Werner Allen. Thank you very much for coming.
So thank you all also for coming for a challenging and interesting presentation. It makes us all think long and hard about what can we do and how can we do it. Oftentimes we throw up our hands because it seems like a chicken and egg thing, and there's no right place to start and no wrong place to start. But that said, we'll start. Thank you again also to our sponsors, Portland General Electric and Riverview Community Bank, to Gresham Barlow School District and MetroEast Community Media. Next month's presentation will be with Dr. Deborah Durr, president of Mount Hood Community College. That'll be on September 1, so the first day of the month, and I invite you to attend that. I think you'll find it fascinating. She's an excellent speaker. She has a great message, and it dovetails beautifully into economic development and workplace development as we look at another opportunity that's available to meet the challenges of this community. Please register online to attend. That's at greshamchamber.org, or you can just call the office and they'll sign you up. Please take a moment also to fill out the evaluation sheets that are at your table. We read those carefully, and they provide us with great insight as to how we all did, things that we can do better, and opportunities for other presentations. Thanks again.
I'm sorry. So as you folks are leaving, I just wanted to say one more thing. I didn't get a chance to put it in earlier. This is a book called Glimpses from the Past. It was prepared at our 50th anniversary. It's very old, and it's falling apart. And this page has fallen out. I don't know if you can see the photo of the shacks people were living in at the time, and I've got the book. You can look at it later. Here's a quote from when the Portland City Council created us just 4 days after Pearl Harbor in 1942. The Portland City Council found that insanitary and unsafe inhabited dwellings existed in Portland, and there was a shortage of safe and sanitary dwelling accommodations available to persons of low income. 1942. Fast forward 73 years, and this is still true. Thank you.